and then hold it down for a little while. There we go. Lovely, lovely. Smoke.
French missiles tend to have quirks that set them apart from their name brand counterparts, but in general, most of them are interesting and a couple of these are really unique and fun to use. Instead of going by missile type, I'm going to go over the Magics first, then move on to the Nord, then go over the big missiles. We start with the Magics. The R550 Magic is the French analog to the Sidewinder. It's common on French jets at 10.0 to 10.3, and you also find it on the A5C. It's also found in the Chinese tech tree under the name PL7 with a slightly different visual model, but the PL7 and Magic 1 are copy-paste in every other way. It's most comparable to the AIM-9P. Functionally, it just acts like a better AIM-9P or a worse PL5B depending on how you want to look at it, but it does sit between those two in terms of performance after its recent buffs. The motor is a very high-thrust, short-burning, single-stage motor, and the Magic is a pretty light missile, so this means it has fantastic acceleration and initially gets downrange very quickly. However, it has no sustainer, and even after multiple drag reductions, it still doesn't glide very far with the current state of missiles being what they are, unless you're at high altitude or firing down on someone. Max G limit is 35G, which is very high, although keep in mind G limit is not the be-all end-all of missile agility, and the high speed is a double-edged sword when it comes to turning radius, so the Magic has a turning radius similar to the AIM-9G, which is an 18G missile. And the proximity fuse arming delay is abnormally high at 1.8 seconds, which isn't a big deal in most cases for the Magic 1, but I'll talk about it more with the Magic 2. For guidance, everything is very normal here. Guidance starts at half a second like almost every other missile, and the flare resistance is the same as something like an AIM-9G, PL5B, or R13M1. And it does have a big enough gimbal limit and radar slaving, which helps it for close range shots. So the Magic 1, after its numerous buffs, is a very good little missile. It's one of the better rear aspect missiles, although still worse than the PL-5B, so the PL-7 is not worth taking on the J-7D. After the drag reductions, the Magic doesn't really have any serious flaws anymore, and for 10.0 or 10.3, you could make the case that it's the best IR missile at that bracket. Next up is Magic 2. You find this on every Mirage F1 and every Mirage 2000. Visually, it's almost the same, but it's got these notches on the fins. In War Thunder, the Magic 2 is basically a Magic 1 with a new seeker. Everything else is mostly identical. The motor has a little less thrust, but 2/10 of a second longer burn time, so it goes a little farther. The agility is the same, the proximity fuse is the same, but now you get a new all-aspect seeker, which more importantly comes with IRCCM. The IRCCM works the same way as the R73's IRCCM. After you launch the missile, the field of view closes down to help the missile see fewer flares. This leads to a missile that becomes nearly unflareable once it gets very close to your plane, especially from rear aspect. Once a Magic 2 gets within a kilometer of you in these situations, your match is probably over unless you can outrun it. It's still possible to flare the Magic 2, especially from front aspect and from longer ranges, but it can be really tough. Dealing with Magic 2s requires good situational awareness to prevent them from being launched from directly behind you. They can also be vulnerable to pre-flaring, and if you see one get launched, start flaring as soon as possible since the closer the missile gets, the tougher it becomes to flare. Unfortunately, it still retains the 1.8 second proximity fuse arming delay, which means for the first 1.8 seconds of flight, the missile needs a direct hit or it will simply fly past its target since the fuse isn't armed yet. Since direct hits are rare, this means the Magic is not good for slamming into your enemy's forehead at point-blank range, something it would probably be situationally good at if it was not for the arming delay. The Magic 2 at 11.3 is incredibly powerful these days. The Mirage F1 only gets two of them, of course, but if you're patient with when you use them, you should be getting at least one kill out of your two launches, with two kills per two launches being very common. At top tier on the Mirage 2000, it's of course still very good, but once again, the problem with French missiles continues to simply be their low quantity. The Mirage 2000C can only carry 2, and the Mirage 2000-5 can carry 4, but you have to give up your radar missiles to do this, while F-16s and MiG-29s are running around with 4 IR missiles minimum. On top of that, the Magic lags behind the R-73 and 9M in a few ways. Both of these missiles comfortably outrange it in the long run, and the R-73 has thrust vectoring for insane close-range shots, while the 9M has a smokeless motor, neither of which are features the Magic 2 has. The Magic 2 is a lot of fun to use, and it's a great missile, but even after the buffs, I still prefer the weapon systems on the F-16s and MiG-29s over the one on the Mirage 2000. But at 11.3, I'm not gonna lie, I've been having a blast using them on the Mirage F1. The Magic 1 and Magic 2 are the only indigenous small IR missiles in the French tree, so we're gonna jump back in time to the AA20 Nord, which you find around 8.3 to 9.3, not to be confused with the very similar AS20 Nord ATGM. The AA Nord is very unique as far as War Thunder missiles go, probably one of the most unique weapons in the game. It's pretty slow, which is common for early missiles, and it isn't very maneuverable at all, and it's definitely nowhere near as responsive as it used to be. What makes the Nord unique is that it's manually guided instead of IR or radar guided. It's the only purpose-built radio-guided air-to-air missile in the game, and the only other missile that comes close in function is the RB-05, which is an ATGM with a proximity fuse. To use the Nord, you need keybinds for horizontal and vertical weapon aiming axis. Make sure relative control is turned off so you see minimum and maximum value. At this point, once you fire the Nord, you use those keybinds to steer the missile in the direction you want. You should see the numbers on the bottom of the screen snap to 0 or 100%. Of course, a keyboard-guided weapon has all sorts of downsides, and the Nord itself doesn't have very good performance at all, so even if you're skilled at driving the missile around, you can't really force it to hit fighters that see it coming. You'll still get some kills with it against bombers or sleeping fighters here and there, but the Nord is really just one of those funny weapons, kinda like the Fire Flash. It isn't particularly good, but it can be a lot of fun to use, and getting the occasional kill with it can be hilarious. The most effective way to use it against fighters is probably going to be firing it from very close range in a head-on and trying to get the proximity fuse to go off on them. I enjoy using the Nord for its unique factor and for how hands-on it is, but I don't really feel any remorse ditching them in the first serious dogfight I get into. Next up we have all of the big missiles, starting with the R511. You only find this on the Valtor 2 in late. This absolute museum piece of a missile is a fossil dating back to the year of our Lord 1957. Naturally, for a missile that old, it's hot garbage. It's very, very slow. Maneuverability actually isn't as bad as you might think. It can pull up to 15G as opposed to 12G it says on the stat card, and it can do some sharp turns, but it's so incredibly slow it can't hit maneuvering targets. What makes the R511 special is that it's a semi-active radar homing missile at 8.3. In theory, you can radar missile some World War II jets. In practice, it's another one of those funny missiles that's so comically bad you can't help but feel a sense of amusement when you get a kill. Not only is the R511 slow, but it's also got a nasty habit of blowing itself up and failing randomly from time to time. And even at higher altitude, most targets, even bombers, have no issue dodging it. IL-28s and B-57s are nimble enough to change direction quick enough that the R511 just can't really keep up. Of course, if you do find a TU-4, the R511 might just be the best weapon in the game for absolutely smiting them out of the sky and making them pay for what they did in 2016. But TU-4s are rare these days, so your kill percentage with the R511 is probably going to be comically low. If you use the R511 expecting to regularly get kills with it, you're setting yourself up for disappointment. But if you're collecting crappy early missiles like the Infinity Stones because you find them amusing, this is definitely one to add to your collection. Next we have the R530. The R530 is the big chunky radar missile carried on the center pylon of the Mirage 3. It's also an option on the center pylon of the Mirage F1C and F1C-200. The R530 is leagues better than the 511. It's much faster and actually capable of hitting most targets. It's not super fast, but with about 9 seconds of total burn time, it just keeps going and has some respectable range for a missile of this BR. And maneuverability-wise, it is agile enough to hit most targets, especially at higher altitudes. It's still possible to dodge, but above 3,000 meters, it becomes pretty scary. The 530 is semi-active radar homing, but the biggest issue with this missile is that it uses a pulse seeker. If you didn't know, SAR missiles can either have pulse or CW seekers. Pulse missiles have the advantage of not setting off the RWR's launch detection if your enemy has an RWR that has that functionality, but they suck at just about everything else. Namely, they are incredibly weak to chaff and they have terrible low altitude performance due to ground clutter. A single drop of chaff almost never fails to decoy a 530, like how a single flare can throw off an IR missile. And pulse seeker missiles have the bad habit of just blowing up mid-flight sometimes, even if you think you're doing everything right and had a very solid lock signal before firing. So the R530 is pretty strong if you can use it up at higher altitudes against enemies that don't have chaff, so it's like other early radar missiles like the AIM-9C in that regard. If you don't want to deal with the limitations of the R530, that's where the R530E comes in. The R530E is the same missile except the radar seeker has been swapped for an IR seeker. Every pylon that can carry the R530 is also capable of carrying the R530E, so which one you take is a preference thing. The IR seeker is similar in field of view and lock range to most rear aspect IR missiles like the Magic and AIM-9G. The 530E is pretty straightforward. It's a big, chunky IR missile. Imagine if the AIM-9G was fat. The 530E is a lot of fun. Of course, it's not particularly nimble and it's not particularly flare resistant or anything, but this makes a nice backup weapon on the Mirage F1, and if you don't feel like dealing with the radar-guided R530's issues, the 530E sort of has that it-just-works factor that makes it a lot less frustrating to use. But like I said, it's a preference thing. Personally, on the 10.0 and 10.3 jets, I take the Radar 530, but on the Mirage F1 center pylon, I take the 530E. Next up is the Super 530F, and as we know, the French absolutely suck at naming stuff, so they couldn't come up with a new number for a very obviously new missile, and no, this is not the last time I will beef with the French naming system in this video. You find the Super 530F on the wing pylons on the Mirage F1. The Super 530F is aerodynamically another nice step up above the R530. Namely, the sustainer is a lot more powerful, which helps the Super 530F in the range department, and the Super 530F is more maneuverable, pulling 20G instead of 15. At 11.3, it's still not as good kinematically as something like an R24R or an AIM-7F, but it is good enough. No, the problem with the Super 530F is that it still has a pulse seeker at a BR where all other missiles have switched over to having CW seekers. That means it still has absolutely garbage chaff rejection, it struggles to lock sometimes, it's nearly unusable rear aspect, and it likes to explode randomly. If this missile did have a CW seeker, it would actually be totally great and really fun to use. But because of that pulse seeker, it's just kind of a heaping pile of disappointment. You can still get kills with it, and like I said, the actual performance of the missile itself isn't bad, but anyone who is paying attention will just one-chaff this missile anyway. So because of that, your primary targets are probably going to be things like Drakens, which don't carry chaff, or targets who you think are not paying attention. The 530F is one of those missiles I want to like, but just can't because of a major flaw. It's supposed to have chaff rejection, and they tried numerous times to add chaff rejection, but broke the missile every time and had to revert the changes. It will very rarely reject chaff right now, but that's not common, and I've only seen it happen once or twice. After the Super 530F, we have the Super 530D. This is because D comes after F in the French alphabet, or it's because the D in 530D stands for Doppler, depends on who you ask. The 530D is the radar missile used by the single-seat Mirage 2000s, and it's pretty much an AIM-7F equivalent. The two missiles are very similar. It's got less sustainer thrust than the 530F, but twice the sustainer burn time, for a total of 10 seconds of burn time, and maneuverability goes up to 30G. It's a little faster than the 7F off the rail, it's got a little less total range than the 7F, and it isn't as maneuverable off the rail as the 7F. The more important upgrade is that we finally see a CW seeker. The 530D is fine, it's not super impressive and it can't compete with the R27ER of course, but it's totally usable and close enough to the 7F or M that if you've used those, you probably have an idea of what to expect from this missile. The problem I have with the 530D is that it has a nasty habit of just missing targets for no apparent reason, which is really frustrating. The R27ER does it too, and I'm not talking about the proximity fuse bug, I mean the guidance just isn't set up correctly so it overcorrects and then misses. Apart from that, it does its job. If you launch first, you'll probably beat the 7M in a joust, but you can't try that with the ER or you'll get smoked. It also works from rear aspect. I feel like a lot of people sleep on rear aspect radar missiles these days. Whether it's worth taking the Super 530Ds or the extra Magics on the Mirage 2000-5 is up to you. Personally, I think I'm enjoying the Magics more right now, but I haven't completely made up my mind. Bonus round, final weapon, AS-30L Nord. This is not an air-to-air missile, this is a laser-guided anti-tank missile that only has a contact fuse, so of course it's pretty horrendous at actually tracking down and killing planes. But if you're playing the Jaguar, I think you should take these and just let them rip because shooting down planes with laser-guided ATGMs is absolutely hilarious. I think I must have fired 40 or 50 of these when I was spading the Jaguar and I only got 2 kills, but watching an ATGM slam into a plane is tremendously satisfying. So I'm putting this in the category of French missiles that are fun for shooting down planes if you don't actually expect them to shoot down a plane when you launch them. I'm sure they're also great for strafing enemies, so there is that too. But the AS-30L is without question the single most based air-to-air missile you will find in the entire French tech tree. So that's all the missiles we have right now. The next step for French missiles is the MICA, which comes in Imaging Seeker IR and Active Radar Homing Variants, both of which would be unfathomably busted if they came to the game right now in their unnerfed form. No clue how Gaijin would shoehorn the MICA EM into the game to go with the early AMRAAM and R77 and PL-12, but you never know. The other thing that could happen is the Magic 2 at some point could go to 50G. It's 35G right now because all air-to-air missiles use single-plane maneuverability, but there's the argument that the Magic 2 could command roll to be able to always pull 50G, so that might be a thing someday. And like I mentioned, chaff rejection for the 530F, but that got promised a long time ago and is nowhere to be seen, so I'm not expecting it. If you found this video helpful, the biggest way to show your support would be by subscribing and leaving a like, it really helps me out. Come hang out on Discord, and thanks for watching.